Frage. Frage.
Hello and welcome to Fishing on Northwest. We're with Tommy Donlin.
What do you think, Tommy? It's the best.
Nice one. Off God's land. And drinking my buddy's homemade wine. Living Northwest wild. Hunting, fishing is my kind of style. I float the Wainuchi when it gets hot. I'm proud of all the things that I've got.
Hello and welcome to Fish Out Northwest. Wayne and Tommy Donlin coming to you from the Fish Out Northwest studio located here in Olympia, Washington. Welcome everybody to the show today. A little rain, buddy, huh?
A little rain because we got a lot of rain. Oh, we got man. More coming too.
It's just starting.
Yeah,
it's just starting. Us taking a little hiatus, heading for some sunshine for a couple days. Probably right on time.
Yeah, I'm going to be swimming on my elk hunt this
weekend. Yes, you are. Yeah, it's going to be nasty, but hopefully them buggers will be out walking around. So lots of content and information to get through tonight, Tommy. Holy cow, I got you some notes piled in there.
Yes, indeed.
So we will get through it all. Welcome everybody to the show. If it's your first time joining us here, especially on Root Sports, I want to welcome you to the show and remind you, please take time, jump over to our webpage, www.fishhuntnw.com. There you're going to find some coupon codes, Edge Rods. Now we've updated that to FHN30. We're actually doing a promo sale, primarily steelhead rods and reel combos. I'll get into that in a little bit, but FHN30, you are now going to save 30% on all fishing rods that are not already attached to a previous sales coupon or reduced in pricing. So quite a significant jump there, Tommy, as we get through, November. Then also, of course, Phelps Game Calls, Fish Hunt NW10 at checkout. All Phelps Game Calls, 10% off through Fish Hunt Northwest through the end of the year. So speaking of that, I went down to Edge yesterday and put together a promo package with the guys. Worked with Big Mike in the pro shop. And hey, it looks like we're getting some steelhead opportunity this season. And if you've been putting it off for a couple of years, I told Alex and Big Mike, like, hey, man, we got to put some combinations together here to get people some new gear in their hands.
Yeah, for
they
sure.
want to be fishing these Edge rods, and let's couple it up with a reel. So got some smoking deals going for you guys. Now, the Silver Widow is the creme de la creme. I mean, it is the top of the line. Really high performance level fishing rod, and you're going to get that anywhere from a 9.3 to 11.4. Mm-hmm. All rods are priced the same. It's just a matter of how long of a rod you want to fish. And the line weights vary from 6 to 15 to 8 to 20. Just fantastic equipment to put in your hand. So the Silver Widow is a high performance rod, but we're coupling that with a reel, either spinning or casting. And you're going to get it with a Daiwa Ballistic 2500X, and that combination for that Silver Widow is $650 out the door. You can also order it online and enter the coupon code. You're going to save money. They'll ship. Casting, you're with a Daiwa Talua and $150. That's $600. Now, I have some of the Black Widow series, which are also fantastic rods. Again, you can get those in 9-ish to 11-foot. 6 to 15, 8 to 20 pound variance there. Spinning with the Daiwa Ballistic again, 2500X, that's a $500 package. That is a really, really good deal. Saving 30% on that rod for sure in the combination. Casting with the Daiwa Tatula, 150, that's 450. That's also a screaming deal. Can't go wrong with that. A casting setup for 450 and it's a Black Widow. Edge rod, you definitely want to take advantage of that. And then also they got their first strike combinations going out the door with spinning combos. The Fuego 2500D, $325 for a first strike combo with a spinning reel or casting with the Daiwa, that's $375 out the door. So you're going to save a ton of money. This sale goes all the way through the end of November. Take advantage of it because you will definitely want to be using it. All right, running down the show, Tommy, we got a ton to get through, my friend. FHN on the water, Coastal River. I was joined by my buddy Scott Call, partner at Brad's, of course. You guys all know him. We joined longtime friend Jared Cady, Get 'em Dry Fishing Company, for a day of fall salmon and a monsoon, Tommy, a flat-out monsoon. Part two of that with Jared and Scott. and we attempted to drift fish some Brad's Super Baits, the Kokanee Cup Plugs. How'd we do? You have to check this out. It's pretty entertaining. Bait Lab, following up the video because we didn't have time. Going to show you the gear and the rigging that we deployed that day and how we found success. Then we get into the nuts and bolts, Thomas. We're going to review Fish and Wildlife Commission Wildlife Committee meeting. I took you guys through this pain a couple weeks ago. Where do I even begin? Wait till you hear what comes out of the mouths of some of the commissioners. Tommy, then you and I are going to spend a couple segments really delving deep here into the Grays Harbor Steelhead Town Hall. How'd it go? Do we have an opportunity to chase steelhead this season? Part two of that is going to be a complete breakdown by the numbers and why we should be fishing this south coastal region this season for sure. So lots of info to get through, lots of entertainment coming your way. Don't go anywhere, jump out for a quick break. We come back, gonna watch parts one and two of Us on the Coastal Rivers with Jared Cady. After this break, right here, Fishing Northwest.
Defiance Marine is the one-stop shop for the Pacific Northwest angler. Defiance Marine guarantees the best price on a new and best service on a repower for your current boat. Defiance Marine is a Honda Premier dealership and one of the largest on the West Coast. Defiance Marine is a boat dealer who proudly sells Defiance, Allied, and Arima boats. All boats are built by West Coast fishermen for West Coast fishermen. Defiance Marine has all your boating needs to help you get out on the water.
If you're looking for the best fishing rods in the world, you really do need to take a look at the Edge rods. I designed and built new machinery, and I think this new machinery has enabled us to build blanks like no other company can build without this equipment. There is no other rods in the world that are as good as these rods. You owe it to yourself to take a good look at them.
All right, guys. Hey, Dwayne England, Fish Hunt Northwest, out here on the water once again. Finally made it to a tributary river.
Yeah.
Finally. And you guys probably recognize these two. All right. Scott Call, partner at Brad's. We fish once in a while together.
Long ways away from home on this one, though.
You certainly are.
This one is. We're like out in Jethroville.
Yeah, we are. Yeah. And longtime buddy of mine, Jared Cady. You guys all know Jared. We fish together from time to time. And thanks for the invite, man.
Yeah. Pretty fun.
You know, water's dropping, gin clear. We haven't had a bump of rain in a bit, but
yep, it's getting low.
There's fish around.
There's a bunch of fish around.
So
be a good season.
What are we looking at?
Coho fishing, probably twitching, throwing spinners, a little bit of bait fishing, just kind of what we see. Water is really low, really clear, so the fish are a little spooky, but we should be able to find one.
We have some other items to deploy.
Tricks up our sleeve.
As well. Huh? Yeah, tricks up the sleeve. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Yeah, we're gonna give that a go. See how that works.
I think that's gonna happen.
I think it's gonna happen. I think we'll get these coho fired up. So get a little daylight, we're gonna hit the water.
So what else is in here? Chum, king now?
Yeah, so we got late kings, mostly wild. Gotcha. So we're letting those go, but some really nice kings. Tons of chum. We're probably looking at a record chum year.
Gotcha.
They're just everywhere.
They are.
There's cohos mixed in with the chums. They come in the same schools.
Yeah.
And then we're just trying to find little pockets of
get
cohos.
Through the chum to get to the coho.
Get to the coho. Yeah. We're gonna have to get through. Good problem to have. You may end up with a sore arm today.
Yeah, it's happened before. That'll, with you, probably, yeah, I think. Yeah.
We'll see what happens. All right, we're gonna get some daylight and get on the water.
Right on.
Sounds good.
I heard that fish. You hear that fish?
Yeah, roller
right here. Boy, that is shallow.
this.
There we go.
Might be a chummy. Here's fish. Nice.
That's how it's done.
That's how you do it. Right behind the boat. Well done, Scotty boy.
There you go.
Yeah. Might have to take the chartreuse head off. There's a fish. That's chummy.
Yeah, it's chummy.
Got a fish. Got a coho there. Oh, yes. That's a nice fish. I think it might be a couple. You see a hook nose? No, it's a keener.
Looks like a keener.
Yeah, he's a little green. Oh, yeah.
Nothing but net.
Nice fish.
Good. All right, got the trifecta.
Yeah, for sure. Oh, that's a nice fish. That looks like a coho. Scotty boy.
All right.
On the eggs.
On the eggs.
Had a kid.
Second cast on the eggs.
It took two. Slacker.
It took two, slacker.
Took two.
What do you do with this guy?
Yeah, it could be a nice little coho.
Yep. Okay.
Out of the wood, nicely done. There we go.
Yep.
Oh, buddy. Well done.
Yeah, boy. Thank you. Better lucky than good, huh?
Hatchery fish, Scott.
Bonk.
There you go. Nice. Right.
I'll take it.
A little brighter than that one this morning. Huh?
Yeah.
Heck yeah.
A little less slimy. We like the less slimy.
Yeah, that's what we want right there.
And in the mouth? Really?
In the mouth.
Huh? What?
On eggs?
Two?
Coho. Whoa.
Coho bite eggs? What?
That was cool. Yep.
Heck yeah. I like it. Oh, Yeah. You know me, I typically do, and I actually get people asking that question. Jared's like, coho eat eggs? I'm like, yeah, coho eat eggs.
There we go. Just that easy.
Hey, well done.
Huh? All right.
Yep.
Allied. The new leader in heavy gauge aluminum boats. Allied boats have standard reverse chine and lifting rakes to help you plane faster and run at lower RPMs. Allied boats have several models to choose from, ranging from a 19-foot Mustang all the way up to a 32-foot Liberator. So regardless of what type of heavy gauge aluminum boats you are looking for, Allied Boats will have it for you. Contact Allied Boats today to learn more about these incredible fishing machines.
Sportco, an outdoor emporium, is the largest local outfitter in the Northwest since 1975, providing thousands of people affordable outdoor gear. This summer, make your next outdoor adventure more affordable by shopping at our warehouse-style pricing. We are a local Scotty dealer, offering sales, service, and repair. Located in Fife and Seattle, come visit us today. The outdoors awaits you. We'll be right back.
CP again, see where you get bit. I was bumping a few. So we'll see.
Oh yeah. Yep.
Scotty's on.
Yep.
Yep. They're grabbing that pink, man. Another chummy?
It's that ladybug.
It's that ladybug.
I should get the size.
Yeah, I should put that on.
You know that lady M one? That would work too.
Yeah. Well, he's getting out of his way. Yep.
This one's just down to one hook.
Nicely done. Yeah.
Yeah, like you're saying, just cast out into that current, get it going, and just super slow retrieve.
Drift fish it, basically.
Yeah, it's exactly what you're doing.
Yep. Look at that thing. Eating the ladybug, the kokanee cup plug.
Yeah, I can't decide on the majority of it. It's hard to decide.
Yep. I think so. Yeah. Nope.
And guess who's got 12 kokanee cup plug twin packs sitting in their box?
Oh, really? Is that what's in there?
Yeah. Buddy, we're going to bring you this way. Here we go. Ready? Nice. Hi, boy. Thank you. Yep. Right there, under the bobber. All right. Dwan's on.
Fish on. Picked it up. Nice.
Okay, I'll get him back. I got him. Yep, I got it. Yep.
Yeah. Uh-huh. This is fantastic. Huh? Look at all these chum. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Look at all them fish. Yeah. This is great, man. They're picking up just slow drifting these.
That's a huge thing, Jared. Yep.
These cocaine
cup plugs. Couple inches up from.
It's working.
It's up to you, but you only have that size.
I'll just take one of those. Just untie one of those and run it through. Yeah. Or if there's another color you think is less likely to use, we'll use that one. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool. I
knew
they'd eat it.
Oh yeah. No.
How can you just get every species?
That would be a pretty.
Is that the MCP,
day.
Dwayne?
What's that?
Is that the mini cup plug or the kokanee?
It's the kokanee. It's the black and chrome.
Yep. Ba-boom.
And then I put that. I put a double little LP squid silver horde. I got a black and UV and a pink. Just a real small skirt. Nothing, yeah. You know, not that big at all.
No, it's just.
Those LPs are real small.
That black pink whole bit. I like it.
Keep going up. Here we go. Love it.
Atta boy.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Look at that guy. Well, hey, they said rain by afternoon, Jared.
Did they?
I think they got it right.
This is just Seattle fog.
So we're definitely now seeing the river just start to come up a little bit. Jared, did you? Did you order up this?
I did. It's about not always about you.
Yeah, it's not always about
my future.
Look, we knew it was going to rain, and we knew it was supposed to rain kind of heavy for the afternoon, but...
It got heavy.
It got heavy. And, man, I'm telling you, I think the river's coming up. We could look at a gauge, but I think it's coming up. And what do we know about a rising river and fish on the move?
Tough.
Really tough, man.
To catch them once they decide to go.
Have to bite. And we saw them moving. They were trucking out.
Oh, my gosh.
We saw pods of them.
I mean, it is exciting to see so many chum return to this region. It is a lot of fish.
A lot. They just keep on coming.
The biomass and the nutrient base that's going to add to these systems.
This river is alive.
Yeah, it's fantastic. So we got a lot of ground to cover as far as, you know, technique points, talking points, kind of what we are doing today. A little tough to do it out here in this weather, so we're going to wrap that up at a different time. But
Some good stuff. I can't thank you enough. We did today.
Yeah. We had a great time. Scott learned how to twitch.
You bet.
Huh? Yeah, what'd you think? You enjoy that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Twitching's good.
It was good stuff.
And we got them on the Kokanee cup plugs.
We got some new stuff.
That was pretty cool.
Liked it.
Yeah. Drift Fish and Kokanee cup plugs. We're going to show you guys all a little
chum,
more.
Chum, coho, king, all everything. Those things.
Mm-hmm. Pretty decent bait bite.
Yeah.
Until the heavy rain showed
up. Until they moved.
That's so.
Yeah.
I think we still all got right. a while yet.
Yeah. Now we're going to get on out of here. So we'll jump out for a quick break. We'll be back in studio right after this.
Support from Northwest Sportsmen make Federal Ammunition the world's leading ammunition manufacturer. Federal uses the industry's finest materials, giving you reliable ammunition that delivers superb accuracy and optimum performance. Northwest hunters rely on Sportco to provide the best selection and prices in the Northwest since 1985. Sportco and Outdoor Emporium in Fife and Seattle. Your journey begins here.
Yep, for sure.
Oh, yeah. Big fish.
Yeah, buddy.
Nice fish.
Oh, beauty.
Gorgeous fish.
Bobby's on the board.
We got a good one.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Oh, geez. Come on.
Nice fish. Nice fish.
We're gonna show you how to make fishing reels.
Been here, but you know it. You've heard the sounds, smelled the air, and seen where your heart lands, if not yet. You haven't been here, but you've longed for a destination near or far, where the young and old find rest and excitement, not apart. You haven't been here, but you're on your way to a place not far. ExploreTheDalles.com.
All right, welcome back here in the studio. We're going to forego the bait lab this evening. No big deal. Lots of content to get through, Tommy. And I want to jump to the Wildlife Committee meeting that I watched here the other day.
Yeah, definitely interesting. I think, you know, and so when we say Wildlife Committee,
it is not to be confused with the Wildlife Commission. The Wildlife Committee is a subcommittee of the commission, right?
Correct.
So the commission, you have 9 panel members, 3 that represent the west side, 3 that represent the east side, and then 3 that are at large. That makes up the 9. And then with the Wildlife Committee, the subcommittee, there are 4 members, of which this committee is chaired by none other than Lorna Smith,
yes,
who has come out and declared her dislike for hunting.
Yeah, you could categorize her almost as anti-hunting.
Yes.
And she is the chair.
She's the chair,
because
yes.
of her expertise to oversee the Wildlife Committee. Now, I don't even know where to start. I sat through this painstaking task of watching it once again, and I kind of covered the previous meeting a few weeks ago mm-hmm. when you weren't here and subjected folks to that. Commissioner Reagan, who is not on the Wildlife Committee but a commissioner, was there as well as another a number of other commissioners observing the meeting. Mm-hmm. And he kind of had a few things to say. It appears he has little to no confidence in the Wildlife Committee's ability to get anything done. I actually took a little excerpt out of that meeting and his statements. Go ahead and look at
that.
Yeah, look at this.
Commissioner Reagan.
Yeah, I don't want to throw, I'm going to look at this as a, I have to look at it as somewhat of a skeptic. When I look at the progress that we've made over the last year or whatever, so and when I look at what we still have to go, I have a lot of concerns. Even the discussion about being able to come up with a model that will tell us how much we can take from these different species in a matter of months, that's really, really hard. I spent 6 years pulling together the one for northern fur seals and 3 years working on one monks. These are complicated things to do. If we don't identify the key things we ought to do and prioritize them, I think we're going to waste a huge amount of time doing things that aren't really the most important things. And I think that's a pattern that we have gone through over and over again. So we know, for example, that we have a petition on cougar and bear that just came in.
I was going to get there.
Yeah, and we need to be able to deal with that. And so leaving that sort of in the background somehow, it doesn't really promote making good decisions on where we're going with that. So I don't know why we can't sit and look at the list of specify. I'm very much in favor of what Woody said. Put it together, a list of what the tasks are that we need to accomplish, but then prioritize those by what are the most important. Because there is a priority. Not every species is in great need of the attention that, say, some species might be. So we need to be a lot more efficient and targeted than just what we're doing now. If I were a member of the public watching this, and even as a member of the commission, I think it's massively confusion, and I don't have confidence that we're necessarily going anywhere.
Well, there you go. Kind, you know, pretty unbelievable.
Yeah.
Like the current commissioners.
It's hard to listen to.
Yeah, right? They don't even have confidence in what the committee is doing and in the fact if they have anything that they can get done. Basically, he stated he has to look at this as a skeptic, right? Mm-hmm. And he goes as far as to say, looking at the process over the past year, looking at where we need to go, I have a lot of concern.
Yeah. Well, rightfully so. My favorite part is, you know, when he says that, you know, if I were a member of the public, mm-hmm. right, or even a member of the commission, mm-hmm. I think it's massively confusing. And I don't have any confidence that we're going anywhere. That's pretty bad.
Well, it's coming from one of your constituents within your nine-person commission.
Right.
Is laser-focused on the committee. The four in that committee have the inability to function and get anything done. Because I got to tell you, it was like watching a soap opera in that apparently you can be gone for 2 years, you know, and come back and they're talking about the same thing. Well, this meeting compared to last meeting, it was like identical. And again, DFW staff did a great job trying to reel them in and keep them on track here.
Right.
But they have these distractions. So, you know, they are tasked with completing the GMP, the game management plan.
Right.
And within that, they have chapters to complete. The overreaching chapter, migratory birds, white-tailed deer, elk, and predator prey. Which, by the way, every time somebody brings up predators or bears or cougars, Smith and Rowland kind of go off the rails and just have this inability to stay on task because somebody mentioned a predator.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, well, you know, and then anytime you want to talk about, you know, cougar seasons, bear seasons, right, they shy away from that, right? They don't want to write that policy. And the way this commission's been operating is that instead of maintaining the policy that is status quo and the game management model that we've had forever, they just say, oh, well, we don't have the data, therefore we can't have a season, right? Mm-hmm. And that's what they did to us with that spring bear hunt.
Yeah, they want to rewrite the policy, tied up in regulation, litigation, all the Asians, just try to tie it up with not getting any work done, so then you can't set or assign seasons. DFW's hands are tied.
And then they use that to just say, well, we don't know, therefore we can't make a decision, therefore you can't hunt.
Yeah.
Right. So they're hiding behind that.
That is the shield that they hide behind, and that is the MO as of late of the Wildlife Committee. I have very little doubt, and I'm not hopeful that they'll get anything completed in November, and we'll roll into 24 with a lot of questions unanswered. So
I agree.
We'll keep on that because it's going to continue. All right, going to jump out for a quick break. We come back. We're going to delve into this Steelhead Town Hall recap. Lots of information to cover there. So don't go anywhere. I think you're going to like what you're going to hear. Back after this break right here, Fish on Northwest.
All Defiance boats are built without any structural wood materials. That is why all boats are backed with a lifetime warranty. All Defiance boats come standard with large fish boxes that are fully insulated so that you can ice your fish properly all day. All Defiance boats are foam flotation filled and unsinkable for the ultimate in safety while fishing offshore. Before you buy any boat, stop by or call Defiance Boats today to ensure you are getting the very best glass boat your money can buy.
If you're looking for the best fishing rods in the world, you really do need to take a look at the Edge rods. I designed and built new machinery, and I think this new machinery has enabled us to build blanks like no other company can build without this equipment. There is no other rods in the world that are as good as these rods. You owe it to yourself to take a good look at them.
New days, new beginnings, new friends, new loves, new dreams, new goals, new scenery, new job. No matter what the next chapter holds, Better Homes and Gardens Real Estate will be there to help you find the new that's right for your lifestyle at any stage of your life. Better Homes and Gardens Real Estate. Expect better.
We're going to show you how to make fishing reels.
All right, welcome back here in studio, Dwayne England, Tommy Donlan, and Tommy, now we're going to walk down Steelhead Lane.
Yeah.
So I sat through and listened to and watched the Steelhead Town Hall last week and took a bunch of notes and kind of watched what was going on. Had my hand raised and wasn't able to make any statement. They had so many people signed on. It's, you know, it is what it is. And you don't have any option for additional input unless you submit it in writing or, you know, call if you can get through and talk to a few folks. But your best bet is to submit it in writing, and it's pretty easy. Go to wdfw.wa.gov/coastal-steelhead and click on that and submit in writing perhaps some of the things that you would like to see as they craft the seasons or opportunity rolling into the 2023-24 season.
Yeah, so you attended the town hall. What do you think? Are we going to have an opportunity to go after hatchery fish?
Yeah, we're going to delve into the North Coast next week with Robert Kratzer, but tonight we're going to focus on the South Coast, and by that I mean Grays Harbor, Chehalis Basin predominantly here, and some opportunity there with some hatchery numbers that are projected possibly, and what the impacts to the wild fish would be. Yeah, I think we got some opportunity here.
That's good news.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so WDFW, they broke it out. They broke out the entire basin and the tributaries to show kind of the distribution of those fish. And then also something that they call diversity.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe you can help kind of explain that term to folks. What does that mean and what did they say?
Yeah, so you're looking at this slide. You know, we hear diversity a lot in common day language anymore. So, it doesn't catch a lot of people off guard. But really what we're talking about is all the different contributors or tributaries within the Chehalis Basin. They all contribute different wild fish numbers, and what we're looking at here is truly just a gauge of wild fish in their return capabilities as of late. We can see that it's continued to go down, although last year we had a slight bump in the sats up in the White Noochie from the previous 2 years. Just not much, but it's helpful in that this represents wild fish, right? Spawning escapement by tributary. Some of these tributaries, don't be misled. They are a very low, almost non-existent contributor. But basin-wide, they all contribute something. Some of them get a lot more wild fish than others. And this is just a gauge or a way of looking at How many wild fish are actually coming back to some of these specific tributaries in that basin?
So when they presented this data and these numbers, are they worried about the impacts to wild fish in the entire basin, in the upper Chehalis watershed? Like, is there a concern?
There is a concern overall, but there is also the ability to target certain tributaries and stay off of the main focus, which is the upper Chehalis watershed returning spawning escapement for wild fish, right? So can we conduct fisheries? And I'm mostly here focused on what they've given us for a number to correlate with impact. Mm-hmm. And if it affords us the opportunity to go after all the hatchery fish, and I'm drilling down mostly on the sats up in Wainuchi.
Yeah.
Right, I'm looking at the sats up in the Wainuchi because those are two tributaries where there's an abundance of hatchery fish. Can we safely go after them and not have a huge impact to the wild fish?
Right, for sure. So they've got, I think we throw up the next slide, mm-hmm. it's going to show that number there on the left, which is 214. And, mm-hmm. and really what that number is the impact on the wild fish, you know, based on that projected number of wild fish in the basin.
So there's 6,000, just shy of 7,000 fish, wild fish coming back to the Chehalis Basin. The recreational impact, which is shared with Chehalis tribe. They contribute to impacting on wild fish as well. They give us a number of 214. That represents the 10% mortality rate. Okay, they're okay with us, supposedly mortality-wise, 214 fish out of the entire season for the entire basin, which means recreational and the component of Chehalis tribe conducting their gillnet fishery, we're going to encounter 2,140 fish.
Yeah.
That would lead to potentially at a 10% margin.
Yeah.
214 being killed.
Yeah, let's talk about the 10% margin for a little bit. And I think, you know, this has always been an issue for me, you know, as somebody with heavy math science background and two engineering degrees, right? Like show me the data.
Does it add up?
Does it even add up? Mm-hmm. And so that's the mortality rate, right? You catch 10 fish, one of them is gonna die. That's what the 10% factor is. And I guess what bothers me the most is, you know, we have guys like, you know, Kyle Buscheman come on. We talk about the broodstock programs for steelhead down in Oregon. And they're catching these fish, you know, they're spawning them, mm-hmm. and then they're releasing them. Mm-hmm. And the mortality rate is 2%.
Uh-huh.
And it's just like, you got to be kidding me. You know, the fish comes out of the water. It goes into a tank on your boat, mm-hmm. goes for a boat ride, gets put into another tank in the river, mm-hmm. gets taken out of that tank, gets taken off, gets, you know, goes through the process, and then gets put back. And it's like 2%. And we are calculating 10%. And when you have numbers at this level, it drastically impacts whether you fish or you, you know, stand on the beach.
100%. The 2% impact on that broodstock programming is interesting because, as you alluded to, I mean, you have all these times where it's handled and put into different tanks and holding and spawned and live release. Mm-hmm. And overall, year in, year out, you know, they stand pretty firm on that 2%. Even if they had a 5%, which I would go, well, that's understandable. These fish are being handled a lot. Yeah. How do you connect a 10% mortality rate to a hook and line landing and release in the river? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's it. Now, that being said, there are a lot of folks that do not handle fish properly.
Yeah.
And these fish that are taken in the broodstock program, caught by professional guides, understand how to handle the fish and how to take care of them. But still, you know, the amount of impact on those fish compared to a catch and release, the 10% is one that they're hanging their hat on. And it keeps us way on the side of conservation, so, you know, I guess we'll go with it.
Conservative.
Yeah. All right, let's jump out for a quick break. Much more to get to on this, so don't go anywhere. Back with more steelhead numbers after the break, right here at Fish on Northwest.
A Northwest favorite for almost 40 years, Arima boats are manufactured with pride in Bremerton, Washington. All Arima boats are built without any structural wood materials. That is why Arima boats are backed with a lifetime warranty. Arima can offer every boat with Honda outboard packages so that you can take advantage of the reliability and 5-year top-to-prop warranty from your Honda outboard. Call or stop by Arima Boats today and let them help you get into your very next boat.
Yep, for sure.
Oh yeah, big fish. Yeah, buddy, nice fish. Beauty. Gorgeous fish.
Bobby's on the board.
We got a good one.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh,
oh, oh, geez, come on.
Nice fish, nice fish.
From Northwest Sportsmen make Federal Ammunition the world's leading ammunition manufacturer. Federal uses the industry's finest materials, giving you reliable ammunition that delivers superb accuracy and optimum performance. Northwest hunters rely on Sportco to provide the best selection and prices in the Northwest since 1985. Sportco and Outdoor Emporium in Fife and Seattle. Your journey begins here.
All right, welcome back here in studio, Dwayne England, Tommy Donlin, and we're kind of working our way through the numbers, buddy, and just kind of putting it out there as if, you know, we think it's reasonable to go after these hatchery fish and not have a huge impact on these wild fish.
Right, and so then that is the question, right? So, you know, for these hatchery fish, what kind of season can we have? Is it going to be a December or January season, December through February? Mm-hmm. Like, what does the data tell you?
Well, so for the past few years, prior to us not fishing for the last 2 years, we've had opportunity typically through February. Now, we used to fish all the way into April. Then we would fish into March. And then kind of started being this February deal. You can see here on the graph, as the hatchery fish increase and then begin on the downturn, we start getting some, you know, higher numbers of wild fish showing up. And there's that crossover point in and around towards the end of February where we have a pretty good mixed amount of both hatchery and wild fish in the water at the time. So you would think at some point here, our encounter rate with wild fish is going to go up and our encounter rate with the hatchery fish is going to begin to diminish. So we got to find that happy medium. It's like, where can we remove as many hatchery fish as we can and then not start having high impact on the wild fish? And I think that towards the end of February, right at the end of February, is a reasonable happy medium. If we stay off March and April, where a high number of wild fish start showing up.
Right, and looking at the data, it basically says that, you know, around that time frame, you know, and you look at the area under the curve for the hatchery fish, it looks to me like about 85% of that hatchery run is pretty much done by that middle of February time mark, right? But if you go past that, right, you get into March, now your impact on the wild fish goes up considerably, right? After that February time frame.
And if we had a lot of wild fish, like years gone by, it would never be an issue. We would be fishing and catching, releasing, and just everybody's fishing. But we have to be cognizant of the fact that we don't have a lot of wild fish, but we still have a duty, and we have to do our diligence to remove the hatchery fish off the water, because why are we planting them? If we can't go after them, why are we putting them in there? And we all know the groups that want to come after us if we have too many hatchery fish hitting the gravel. So we gotta find a resolution to this thing and figure out how to make it happen. So I like the fact that they have broken down, in particular, you know, we can look at the sats up in Wainuchi, for example. They've broken it down by river and numbers that correlate with each one. You can see that, you know, our impact of catching wild fish for, say, the sats up in the Wainuchi is a pretty decent amount of fish caught and released with the correlating mortality on that, if it, in fact, we hit 10%. But the amount of fish to catch within 3 months, say December, January, February, to get after them hatchery fish, we can encounter a pretty good number
about
of wild fish.
Yeah, about 1,000 on the Wainuchi and sats up. And when you think about that chart that we just showed, that showed kind of the area under the curve for both hatchery and wild, you know, the majority of that wild run hasn't even come through by that February timeframe.
Yep.
And so, you know, I think you got a really good opportunity to get the hatchery, but not the wild, right? Doesn't that what the data tells you?
Yeah, that's what the data would show. We are going to start encountering some wild fish at some point. Mm-hmm. And, you know, those early, early fish that might trickle in, you know, there's numbers associated with that that we want to try not to exceed. And we were talking about the diversity a little bit earlier, and we're going to get into this here. So we can hook and release 410 fish on the Wainuchi and 620 on the SAT sub. I really like the fact that it breaks it down, forecasts impact limit or mortality rate by month. So now we're looking at the contribution per tributary, and now we're going by month to see what the actual impact per month could possibly be, and or what we can afford is what this is really saying, right? Ooh. So we look at the month of December, for example. We're going to take the month of December. We can encounter and release 24 wild steelhead on the Wainuchi, 36 on the SATSUP. I can tell you that I think we'd be hard-pressed to encounter 36 wild fish on the SATSUP in December.
Right.
Now, that run timing, we've begun to see earlier hatchery returning fish on that river than we did years ago, is one thing I mm-hmm. noticed the last few years that we were fishing it, which is a good thing. I want to see more hatchery fish in there in December because yeah. that gives us opportunity to go after them. So if we're at 24 on the Wainuchi and 36 on the SATSUP, that's telling me that we have, should have, pretty good opportunity to get after them as far as the hatchery fish and not have a lot of encounters. That being said, though, we have days on that Wainuchi where there is potentially 50, 60 boats, especially on weekends. Mm-hmm. So do you think in December on the Wainuchi we could potentially catch 24 wild steelhead with 50 boats a day for multiple days in a row? If the fish are there, yeah. the potential is there.
There's a potential there. That assumes you can get past the plethora of hatchery fish that are in the system at the same
sure.
time. Also assumes that you've got good water conditions to be able to fish, right,
yeah.
as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we may let's say that does happen. So what does that mean? In December, we can catch, like I said, 36 on the Wainuchi, or 36 on the SATSUP, 63 on the Wainuchi in January, 96 on the SATSUP in January.
Yeah.
Okay. February, 87, Wainuchi in February, 133, which could potentially happen because now we have more wild fish coming in.
Yeah.
So what does it mean if we're hitting those marks per month, if we go up against that number?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that. Don't go anywhere. We're going to jump out for a quick break. We're going to break those important numbers down and how this correlates to whether or not we fish or not. We come back after this break right here at Fishing Northwest.
Defiance Marine is the one-stop shop for the Pacific Northwest angler. Defiance Marine guarantees the best price on a new and best service on a repower for your current boat. Defiance Marine is a Honda Premier dealership and one of the largest on the West Coast. Defiance Marine is a boat dealer who proudly sells Defiance, Allied, and Arima boats. All boats are built by West Coast fishermen for West Coast fishermen. Defiance Marine has all your boating needs to help you get out on the water.
If you're looking for the best fishing rods in the world, you really do need to take a look at the Edge rods. I designed and built new machinery, and I think this new machinery has enabled us to build blanks like no other company can build without this equipment. There is no other rods in the world that are as good as these rods. You owe it to yourself to take a good look at them.
For more than 90 years, you've entrusted one brand to guide you towards living the lifestyle you've always dreamed of. Now you can entrust Affiliated Better Homes and Gardens Real Estate Professional to interpret your needs and help you find the home in which to live your dream. Through every stage of your home buying or selling process, and through every stage of your life, there's Better Homes and Gardens Real Estate. Expect better.
All right, welcome back here, Fish on Northwest. So we're delving into the numbers, Tommy. I want to throw that slide back up and really show what this means. So in conversations with staff at DFW and breaking it down, like we're being ultra conservative, diversity in run timing and when they arrive, and we're not trying to take too many off the front edge. We don't want to whack a bunch of wild fish on the front side of this thing and say, oh, we got a bunch of money in the bank at the end, so we'll be fine. It's like, just do an average. Well, it doesn't work on an average. So in December, let's say it's December 23rd, and we have accounted for 24 wild fish
on the Wainuchi.
On the Wainuchi, per creel surveys that they'll be conducting at the takeouts. They're going to close the river.
Yeah.
They're going to close it until January 1.
Yep.
Then we get to go fishing again. Let's say January gets through and we hit 62 fish and it's December, or it's January 30th.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, well, we're probably still fishing. Go ahead, George. We haven't hit up against the wall. Right. And then as we get into February, the numbers are even greater. We have more opportunity to spend more time on the water. Mm-hmm. There's going to be more wild fish around, but as long as we don't exceed those numbers, if we do, if it's February 15th, and on the SATSUP, we have accounted for 140 wild fish, we're done.
Yeah, it's all relative though, right? The numbers are relative to the size of the wild run at that time.
Correct, and it's that diversity component.
Right, so the diversity in this sense is really talking about, hey, we do not want to kill all that wild fish, you know, impact. We don't want to have that impact all front loaded because we want to be able to have spawners in December, spawners in January.
Correct.
All the way out to April, right?
Yep.
If you front load all your impact, now you're taking all those spawners out of the front end, right? And you can think of it in terms of like natural disasters. You have a huge mudslide in that time frame between December and March, and you wipe out the entire run for that month.
Yeah.
Well, if that's the month where you've now created all of your spawners in, the entire run's dead, right? So that's that diversity piece.
That is, and it's not like you can cash in at the end to make up for what you already destroyed at the front side. So we got to be cognizant of that. The other key component here is, look, we've been asking for, well, if I get told I'm on the sidelines because we don't have money for creel samplers at the takeouts, now they say we have money to
That's what they told us a couple years ago, right?
Yeah. Now if they say we have budget, there will be creel surveyors at the takeouts, SATSUP Wainuchi, contributing tributaries to this Chehalis Basin. We are looking for factual data.
Right.
It's to our advantage to give them factual data. You encounter two wild fish and let them go, you should tell the creel sampler that.
Yeah.
I don't want to hear this stuff like, no, if we tell them that, they're going to shut us down.
Right.
If the co-managers are finding wild fish in their gill net fisheries, and we are reporting zeros,
right.
it doesn't jive.
Right. That
we have to provide good signs. The reason down in Oregon they're so successful in these broodstock programs is because all the players know the rules.
Yeah.
And they engage in it professionally, and they want to help rebuild these fish runs.
Yep.
We can't do that by playing this, you know, cat and mouse game and think we're going to outsmart DFW.
Right.
We have to provide accurate data, Tommy, so that when they go to the table, they can start building true data points, and they can start utilizing factual information specific to this basin, not utilizing things generated from around the coastal region.
Right. We want to be part of the data collection for sure. And then in the chat, Paul Vesey had a good question. He said, hey, are they gonna let you fish from boats? And yes, this is the proposed fishery, 7 days a week from a boat, no problem.
Yeah, so it you know, when I hear, hey, and they've put the numbers out there.
Mm-hmm.
Look, here's the benchmarks and the guardrails to conduct fisheries per month. Let's stay between the guardrails and let's go fishing.
Mm-hmm.
Why would they handcuff me then if they got creel samplers at the takeouts and want to know how we're doing?
You have real-time data.
Don't preclude people from fishing from boats. There's no need to.
Right.
We have the ability, and the fish are here, the hatchery fish are here. Give us the opportunity to go catch them in normal fishing circumstances.
Yep.
Don't preclude people who can't access from bank. Don't take the senior citizens out of the game that aren't so mobile anymore.
Right.
Don't take the handicap out of the opportunity to be with a guide pulling plugs, because that's a great way to go after steelhead. Mm-hmm. So there should be no restrictions, no handcuffing. If they're going to give us these seasons specific to SATSUP Wainuchi, Skookumchuck is a component as well because of the amount of hatchery fish they put into the system. But if we're going to talk about rivers that were floating in boats in fishing and opportunity, gravel bar access, yeah, sure, but doggone it, let's stay in the boats. Let's be honest with the creel samplers. Let's go after these hatchery fish so they don't create problems down the road.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? Let's go fishing.
Yep.
So submit your recommendations to DFW and make sure you don't let it go by just waiting for everybody else to do the work. They need to hear from us. We need to get our fisheries back. And there's a reason why we should be on the water, and the numbers tell us exactly why. Okay. Nice job, Tommy. Good info out of that. Let's jump out for a quick break. when we come back, I'm going to wind it down, close up the show.
Defiance Marine is the one-stop shop for the Pacific Northwest angler. Defiance Marine guarantees the best price on a new and best service on a repower for your current boat. Defiance Marine is a Honda Premier dealership and one of the largest on the West Coast. Defiance Marine is a boat dealer who proudly sells Defiance, Allied, and Arima boats. All boats are built by West Coast fishermen for West Coast fishermen. Defiance Marine has all your boating needs to help you get out on the water.
If you're looking for the best fishing rods in the world, you really do need to take a look at the Edge rods. I designed and built new machinery, and I think this new machinery has enabled us to build blanks like no other company can build without this equipment. There is no other rods in the world that are as good as these rods. You owe it to yourself to take a good look at them.
For more than 90 years, you've entrusted one brand to guide you towards living the lifestyle you've always dreamed of. Now you can entrust affiliated Better Homes and Gardens real estate professional to interpret your needs and help you find the home in which to live your dream. Through every stage of your home buying or selling process, and through every stage of your life, there's Better Homes and Gardens real estate. Expect better.
All right, welcome back here, Fish Hunt Northwest, as we close it out. Rob Larson makes a good point, have people requesting and fishing from boats for coho in December. We already have that agreed to fishery, so we should be full on conducting fishing from a boat, Satsup, Wainuchi, even on the Chehalis. The opportunity's there. Now, if they got to curtail the opportunity maybe on the Chehalis to stay off of, if they're fearful of those early returning steelhead, I could see that. But as far as tributary contribution and Satsup Wainuchi, coho opportunity, and then catching those early steelhead, that should be a no-brainer. Yeah. That's already agreed to fishery.
Yeah,
and we've lost out on that the last couple of years. So lots of good questions on here and stuff, guys. I'm trying to get through them. Appreciate everybody chiming in. We have a lot of work to do. Want to make sure you are contacting DFW to let them know exactly what you think about, you know, the up-and-coming opportunity. Take a look at the numbers. Go to the DFW webpage, pull up that slide presentation. All the numbers are there, Tommy. You can see every slide that James Losey and staff put together, all the information they provided. Now, we'll give them, you know, I give them a lot of credit because they've come the last 3 years now, each year with a little more information. They're like digging a little deeper. They're trying to compile data that makes sense to the layperson so you understand what their goals are. I just really think they also need to exercise the opportunity for us to be on the water, go after the hatchery fish, because I don't want to hear from the wild fish groups next year that
there's too many hatchery fish in the system.
NOAA needs to intervene now, and we need to stop planting the hatchery fish. That is not the ultimate goal here. The ultimate goal is to get people back on the water, make sure everybody's fishing. We're going after these hatchery
fish. Create an opportunity.
So, for sure. A couple things to think about. We got a ton of rain coming through the weekend, a ton of rain. So, if you're a duck hunter, congrats. It's going to be a great time. If you're not, time to go buy that duck stamp. Pull the shotgun out of Grandpa's closet and get after it. So, great opportunity coming up as far as duck hunting. We got some sturgeon retention changes we'll get into next couple weeks. It doesn't even take place till January. Lots of things to look forward to. And Snohomish system updates are that they've opened it back up, Tommy, salmon November 1st through November 30th. Daily limit is 2 again. So you're back there catching coho in the Snohomish system. So that's always good. You're gone the next couple weeks on hunts?
I am. Yes, I am.
Elk hunt, whitetail hunt.
Yeah, Western Washington hunt this this next week, and then after that, we're going for whitetail.
All right, well, I'll be here the next couple of weeks, taking a week off Thanksgiving, which is 3 weeks down the road, so we'll do that. But other than that, join us here each and every week. We appreciate bringing you the information. We appreciate you tuning in. So that's going to do it for us this week here, Fish Hunt Northwest. Have a great week. Have a great weekend. We'll see you next time right here, Fish Hunt Northwest.